Namaste, hello, and welcome to India Global Week 2020, where India has a new, better world. I'm your host, Priyanka Deo, reporting from New Delhi, and it has been a fabulous day with fabulous guests and really insightful panels. With that being said, I'm super excited because I've just heard since morning that we have registered attendees from 52 different countries. Follow us on India Incorp, that is at India, I-N-C-O-R-P, throughout the day and throughout this conference. With that being said, if you have questions, if you have thoughts, if you have pictures that you want to post or screenshots that you're posting, be sure to post it with hashtag BeTheRevival. I'll be tracking them and hopefully we can answer or reply to some of your questions. So with that being said, we now have two parts of the next session, which is sponsored by India Inc. The first part is a keynote and the second part is a panel discussion. Now, the special keynote is from humanitarian and spiritual leader Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, followed by a panel discussion on tech collaboration, spurring innovation for global good. With that being said, let's begin this power-packed session. I'd like to introduce our moderator, Mr. Nikhil Deogan, the CEO of the Americas US Senior Partner of Brunswick Group. Nikhil, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Priyanka. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are. It's a delight to be with all of you on this occasion. Thank you for having us. You're right, we have a wonderful discussion set ahead. So let me just very quickly introduce our members on this group. Obviously, there's Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, who is the Cabinet Minister for Communications, Electronics and Information Technology and Law and Justice for the Government of India. A man who wears many, many hats. In our world, he wouldn't all fit all of that in one line. So you have a very busy job. Sri Prasad is going to give some remarks for about 5 minutes, and then we will have a Q&A with the minister, but alongside two very distinguished and accomplished individuals, Rajan Magadia, who is the Vice President and President of Qualcomm India and runs Qualcomm India, and Surya Kant, who's the president of North America, UK, and Europe for Tata Consultancy Services. So it's a pleasure to have this August group. Who better than to discuss the title of this panel, which is Tech Collaboration, Spurring Innovation for Global Good. In a time of extraordinary disruption, I think it's vital that we keep this dialogue going, because I think technology is probably the future for connecting all of us in the world and creating a better place. So thank you all for joining us. And with that, Sri Prasad, I'm going to turn it over to you for some remarks, and then we will follow that up with some Q&A. And I know we're on a tight time schedule, so we'll move quickly. Thank you, sir. Okay. Are you guys ready for us?
Yes, we are.
Great. Sri Prasad, go ahead.
Nikhil and all the members of the panel and all the participants, greetings to all of you. Nikhil, had a caveat at the very outset. I was supposed to speak for 15 to 20 minutes. Okay. That's the impression given to me. You have reduced it to 5 minutes. Unilaterally, I will settle midway at 10 minutes. Okay.
Sounds good.
That's the India, the story you need to know.
Perfect collaboration already.
And to the anchor from Delhi, I am not the spiritual Ravi Shankar. I am Ravi Shankar Prasad, the minister. Friends, we are indeed meeting in very challenging times. When in India, the railway, the aeroplane, and the roadways all were closed, my ministry worked effectively to keep India talking, indeed India talking to the global world. I wish to congratulate all the people of technology, those present here. 85% of India's IT industry worked from home. We liberalized the entire regime and served the 500 Fortune companies which the Indian IT companies serve. The Digital India program launched by our Prime Minister came in great handy to this. Digital India, simply put, is designed to empower ordinary Indians with the power of technology, bridge the digital divide, and most important, lead to digital inclusion. How we did it earlier and reinforced in COVID. We opened India's digital profile to my delegates' friends hearing me is very well known. Population 1.3 billion plus, mobile phone 1.2 billion, Aadhaar card, the digital identity to confirm the physical identity, 1.26 billion plus. We opened 370 million bank accounts to the poor, linked that with Aadhaar and mobile, started sending all the welfare measures to the bank account. We sent close to 145 billion in the last 5.5 years. And we saved how much? More than 22 billion, which used to be pocketed by middlemen. During COVID, what we did, and I would very much like that to emphasize, that I'm really grateful to my Prime Minister, 4.12 billion was given as cash assistance to 206 million women in their bank accounts. 1.13 billion worth of relief has been given to 85 million households, and 2.38 billion has been disbursed to cash assistance to 89 million farmers. And free ration is being distributed to 810 million people of India since April till November. Now, all this has been facilitated because of digital platforms. India's UPI, a digital platform, has registered $35 billion of digital payment during this whole challenging times. Therefore, technology has empowered people. I'm happy to share with my friends in London that we have a platform of common service centers where we are delivering fruits globally. I come from Bihar, and the lovely lychee has been transported digitally after digital booking to London, to Germany. And the pineapple of Tripura has gone to Dubai. Therefore, digital ecosystem is empowering farmers of India. Now, I handle electronics also. I would like to flag generally views, and I like to hear the comments of my friends on the panel. Now the time has come for a more robust global supply chain. A global supply chain which addresses the most fundamental issue that manufacturing base needs to be diversified. It should not only be in one country. India, because of the way we are trying to empower ourselves, in electronic manufacturing, we had just two factories. My friends from Qualcomm would recall that when we had come to power. India today is home to more than 250 mobile phones manufacturing, the best global brands. And recently, we have launched a new scheme of production link incentive, and all the global companies are coming to India. We want global champions to come to India. We want Indians to become national champion in sync with global champion, because we want Indian economy to become competitive as a part of larger world economy in this world. That is indeed very important. Digital agriculture, digital supply chain, digital education are all becoming key areas. Something about data I need to share, and I would like to hear the friend comments of my friends. Is it not important that post-COVID, a proper reflection is done that a true digital world can only survive in a democratic world? Do we need to have more transparency in our data management, in our data ecosystem? As far as India is concerned, I am very clear, and so is my Prime Minister. Data sovereignty shall not be compromised. Any sort of data imperialism is also plainly unacceptable. You may have seen, to protect the data of Indians, the privacy of India's security, we have taken some tough measures, and we shall continue to take those measures, because it is very important that now there is a more transparent exchange of the data requirement and also the digital ecosystem, which rest upon surer foundations. That's very clear. We have introduced a data protection law awaiting clearance of parliamentary committee, where we have said very clearly that there must be consent, that consent must be uniform consent for a specific purpose, and the trustee of data must handle it well. We have said sensitive personal data, then non-sensitive personal data, and the whole, and a data protection authority. All these are in the realm of legislative progress. But let me conclude, my friends in the panel and those delegates, that post-COVID is going to be a different world. This world will seek more accountability. This world will seek more transparency. And this world will need more and more openness. The essence of a digital world is what? Transparency. But at the click of a button, everything is available. This system must be maintained in a robust manner, due regard to privacy, due regard to data security and safety, and proper containment of surveillance. The data of one country should not become the surreptitious property of some other country to be pilfered, to impinge upon defense and security. That, I think, is some of the great challenges which we have to confront with. But yes, let me conclude by saying just one line. India has shown to the world as to how inclusive development can be achieved through digital technology. And I think this, from digital payment to digital delivery of services, to e-agriculture, to e-scholarship, to e-hospitals, to digital literacy, all are going to become a robust ecosystem of the developing and emerging world. That I think we need to work with together. And surely, there must be sharing of technology, but the sharing should be in a manner which is fair, which is balanced, and ultimately lead to empowering of ordinary individual. That's what I felt I must share in these times. Let us keep the information highways intact, strong, and resurgent. Thank you, Nikhil.
Mr. Prashad, thank you very much. And you were right at 5 minutes. So thank you for that. You're very succinct.
I can see that you're looking at me.
I wanted to say one follow up, and then Rajan, I'd like to start with you to jump in.
Namaste, and it's good to see you again. Priyanka Deo over here. You were promised 15 minutes, sir, and you are going to get your full 15 minutes. So we do have some questions for you from the audience. The first question, because there's quite a few questions that are coming in. First question that I would like to ask is that, Minister Prasad, I think you're muted.
Is it okay now? You're hearing me?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Priyanka, I'll surely take your questions, but let me first talk to the panel first. Nikhil is waiting for that. And thereafter, I'll take your question.
Panel, the panel can wait. The panel can wait. We are going through with 15 minutes. If you would like to continue, you can continue. All otherwise, right. There's a plethora of questions that we have to ask you. Whichever one you
go ahead with the question. No problem. Nikhil, it is your turn to wait now. Yes.
I'm happy to wait.
All right. Is that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, just recently launched the Atmanirbhar Bharat Innovation Challenge to identify the best Indian apps that are already being used by citizens and have the potential to scale and become world-class apps in their respective categories. Now, considering the recent ban on Chinese apps, how does the IT ministry plan to support the PM's initiative here?
First of all, you must understand, I'm happy you have raised this question. I was anticipating this question, therefore I didn't speak about it. India has come with great innovations. Aadhaar, ultimately made in India. Low cost technology, a great word. 1.26 billion on digital identity, safe, secure with due regard to privacy. GSTN, UPI, the biggest digital payment movement in the country, in the world today, with 35 billion transactions. Then Ayushman Bharat, nearly 50 million Indians today are there seeking medical help of more than half a million rupees. In this light, India's app economy is a huge economy. What is the essence of this program launched by the Prime Minister is, we download a lot of apps. We must learn to upload apps made in India. And the technological prowess of India's, which has, I just outlined, will surely be of great help. We'll be giving them financial incentive, we'll be giving them other incentives. And just on a point of factual reference to you, more than 800 requests have already come by young people, startups and other companies who are keen to make a good Make in India app of global standards.
Great. The next question that I have, now you've made some interesting points in that question. Scheme or which policy or maybe a combination of both is the Ministry of IT and Communication planning to put in place to support startups? As you just said, a lot of young people are getting on board for Atmanirbhar Bharat or Self-Reliant India.
We have many schemes. First is a general scheme. We give them funding also. There is a lot of tax incentives which are given to them, to the startups. A lot of venture funding is coming. In response to your query, I must tell you that we have 26 Indian startups who have become unicorn. And unicorn simply means a startup having a turnover of $1 billion plus revenue of that. Now, this shows how India's startup movement, which started hardly a few years ago, has become the third biggest movement in the world. Therefore, a lot of venture funding is going into that. And I'm very happy. I'm sitting here talking to you. I need to compliment global investors, many of them Indians, and also Indian venture investors, companies who are handholding them, apart from our own scheme, whereby we fund them through a lot of primary and secondary funding by creating the daughter funds to fund them in all. That's how we are doing it.
Great. And there's another very interesting question, and I'll just read it out. India needs a lot of people, a lot of entrepreneurs, especially youngers, are asking for a robust data protection law because it's becoming increasingly important, especially since so many of us are on the internet and so many of us are online users now with smartphones. What are your views on it, or what are your thoughts on it?
Well, I must tell you, since I have been handling communication and IT for some time, it is now 6 years that I have been IT Minister of India, and my second term as a communication minister. Certain rules of the game we have set for ourselves very clearly. When the Western world was grappling with the issue of net neutrality, I said very clearly, without going to that debate, I told the Parliament, a right of access of internet is not negotiable. And that remains very clearly. And therefore, my good friend Mark Zuckerberg, when he came with the idea of free basics and sought a license, once I examined that, I turned it down because you could get free only when you could enter through the gate of Facebook. I said, no, India is a democracy. We believe in many gates. One gate is clearly not acceptable. And I did not permit. And I'm happy he appreciated my point. Now, data protection law, after a serious consultation by under the leadership of a retired Supreme Court judge, Judge Sri Krishna, a very eminent judge, we have come with an idea, which I told in my initial comment. It is being examined by the Select Committee of the Parliament. The essence is what? Number one, a data cannot be taken without the consent of the individual, Indian. That consent must be voluntary. And the data shall be used only to the extent of consent given, not things beyond that. Next, the data fiduciary who will collect the data is supposed to be the trustee of that data. And then the idea of is of your data protection authority. Basically, three types of data is there. Super sensitive data, which will be in India, then sensitive data, and then a general data. But we are equally keen that India must become a big center of data refinery, of data cleaning, of data processing. We generate billions of data. In Aadhaar, I can tell you, every 3 minutes, 30 million data authentication is done. That is our capacity because India is a huge country in terms of population. Therefore, with a very robust data law, we are coming. But as I said initially, we are very, very particular. India shall not compromise on its data sovereignty, number one. And the open society, democratic world need to acknowledge that a fair data regime thrives developed only in a democratic ecosystem. That's the, and any kind of data imperialism is plainly unacceptable to us. I thought these are our views on data.
Great. Thank you, Minister Prasad, for answering some of our audience questions that are coming in and being so gracious with your time. Really, really appreciate it. If you guys, if any of the audience, if we didn't get to your questions, please use the hashtag #BeTheRevival and ask the minister questions, ask any of the passions that we've had today, and keep watching. Stay tuned for our session. With that being said, we're going to go right to our next panel discussion. I'm going to hand it over to Mr. Nikhil Deogan, and the panel is titled Tech Collaboration, Spurring Innovation for Global Good. Thank you, Minister Prasad, for your time. Let's go to the next session.
Thank you.
Mr. Prasad, can I jump in with a question based on what you said, and then I would like to get the views of the panelists. One is you mentioned you've been very pleased with some of the foreign investment in India of late, and we've seen obviously a number of announcements. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the initiatives that you have, and particularly for, you mentioned supply chain as well, particularly as it relates to companies looking as an alternative to China? What is India doing, and what else could it and should it be doing?
First of all, I would not like to take any name of any country. But let me explain to you, when we talk of Atmanirbhar Bharat, Nikhil, Atmanirbhar Bharat does not mean India inward looking. It simply means India positive. We have from the biggest FDI receipts in the last few years, and mostly in the two portfolios I'm handling, the IT and telecom and electronics. Now it is all completely free. There are certain security restrictions which we always follow. The route is automatic. That is number one. India's gig economy is rising very fast. With the great success of work from home, today Indians can work anywhere in the world, and anywhere can work anywhere in India. After all, India has been a big center of back-end offices. My friends from Qualcomm and TCS will know it very surely. 85% of the work could happen because I liberalized the entire regime of work from home, etc., etc. Thirdly, when I talk of supply chain, there is a context to it. India is the biggest center of Facebook, of WhatsApp, of app download. India is the most rising economy in terms of startup. India is the most rising economy in terms of digital payments. Now, digital supply chain is going to become a very important aspect of the whole trade intercourse as I foresee in future. In that light, ease of doing business we have done, you know that we have scaled more than 3 point. We are also changing the lot, about 2000 old rules we have annulled completely. Most of the things, applications are today online for your registration, etc. But what is important is India has the capacity, the human resource, the technological talent to become an important component of global supply chain. That's how I meant that. And therefore, you may have seen electronic manufacturing I just mentioned to you. First week of August, it was to close. And we have already received very, very significant investment proposal as far as production link incentive is concerned. That's how I foresee India.
So in order for a lot of this to happen, it feels like 5G and the rollout of 5G is very critical. Tell us a little bit about how to make sure India doesn't miss the bus on 5G.
India will not miss the bus on 5G. Okay. India is too big a country to miss any bus for that matter. And our technological background confirms that. On 5G, there are issues which I must share with you. The first is 5G itself is evolving. In some country, it has concretized. But the nuances of 5G, its speed, its capacity for development, and its capacity for disruption, both are very, very deadly. I hope that. And you need to develop a proper, my friends from Qualcomm will further confirm that there has to be a very robust security apparatus, including security of the country, when we talk of 5G. So all these factors we are working into, we are shortly going to encourage this 5G trials. Once we have already given a good amount of money to ITI Madras, a leading technological institution, to develop the model for that. All that work is going on. But if you see, have we heard the last word on 5G? I would say no. 5G is still in a trial stage. But what is important is the challenge which we have faced and the challenge which we are still facing post-COVID further reinforces the need to erect a strong security architecture as far as 5G is concerned. That's my general view I thought I must share with you.
Thank you. And on that point, Rajan, maybe you can chime in because obviously that's something near and dear to Qualcomm's heart. You heard the minister on 5G. Is what else should be done? Is that enough? Comment a little bit about that. Rajan, you're muted.
I would like to take a bit of a moment to just thank Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad. I think India, and you guys are both seated outside of India, despite being Indians, but we who, as a citizen of India, I can tell you that if it was not the vision of our minister and his departments, I think we wouldn't have been as efficient and as, I would say, comfortable to work out of the homes for the last 4 months. Companies like ours, which are totally working from home. By the way, just to give a sense, we are 26 years old in this country. So we might not many people know that Qualcomm came in 1994 to India, and we have 10,000 plus employees in India, all engineers, skilling, working on the cutting edge technology. So it's the largest center outside of San Diego or US, the largest R&D is happening in India. So while we do this, we can see how this country managed these tough times. All of a sudden, everybody was working from home. Enterprises were working from home. Citizens were working from home. I want to thank you, Minister Saab, that this probably wouldn't have happened if this was probably not the vision and the Metis, the DPIITs, the Niti Aayogs have been so open to support every single person who has gone to them. So I cannot be more proud than what I am today as an Indian. And to quite a few of these questions on 5G, I think 5G, as Mr. Saab said, it is very important for India to go to 5G way. I don't think people like us also who are more Indian than American, to be honest, would let this bus go away. Security is important, very, very important, especially when we go to industrial IoT, which is essentially a big part of 5G. We will have to take care of it. We work very closely with the industry locally. And I tell you, some of these things, like, for example, Arogya Setu app, which by far, I would say, it's a feather in our cap, which was from ground up to 10 crore of people downloading it in a few days and using it, is something which I'm very proud that used some of the fundamental technologies and innovations that Qualcomm had made in terms of location services. And we, Minister Saab, actually, we also did something. We optimized that app for better battery consumption, because when you use the app very frequently, it does consume a lot of power.
We are very pleased
to offer that support, and we work with Meti, Swani Saab and team to see that this was optimized. So I tell you, this country is posed in a very, very different. I've been 30 years in this country, and right through, fortunately, in telecom. I haven't seen the movement, especially the schemes like PLI, all of these schemes which you brought in, I haven't seen in my career. I've been a manufacturing guy I was an entrepreneur in my life in the past. But this is probably the golden era of this telecom industry in India. I don't think 5G will be missed. The 5G hackathon, which probably is one thing I'm so proud we launched. We have been in our own way as Qualcomm a part of that hackathon to support, to help. It's such a wonderful idea of identifying the 5G use cases, because the importance of 5G is multiple dimensional. And we probably would like to use those elements of 5G, because 5G is so vast. Point is, what is more relevant for India, we want to pick it up. For example, 5G can help us take care of the last mile issue of fiber optics. I think millimeter wave and all that would be helpful when it gets auctioned. Very important. Applications, very important. I think it was so beautiful when we saw this hackathon that we are inviting, and there are, I would not be in the liberty to disclose the participants and which parties which came on, but there is such an amazing response to that. And probably by somewhere around October to December, we would have identified those use cases on 5G. All of these is actually ingredients towards building the 5G network in India. Of course, auctions and spectrum and trials are very important, as we heard. So I'm very excited I think that India is posed. Yes, we have challenges, but trust me, the one answer India gave in the times of COVID, where nothing stopped. Everything was equally efficient. Not a single developmental activity at Qualcomm stopped. Qualcomm Indian engineers delivered to the global standards, global technology development. There is not a single delay in any of our technology rollouts when these 10,000 engineers worked out of their homes. So I can tell you, we are so robust, we have so much of resilience, and we are so strong, and we are very positive about it. So I tell you, 5G is there. We are definitely not going to miss the bus.
Thank you, Rajan. Surya, could you just comment a little bit about, we're obviously in unprecedented times, and part of resilience is also making sure there's enough job creation. TCS, I always think of as one of the greatest job creators in the world, and just in terms of the number of jobs you've created. As you look through the pandemic and as you, in the context of technology and what needs to be done from an innovation and spurring global good, tell us a little bit about what's worked, but also tell us a little bit about how technology, as we're entering this phase where obviously there's going to be a lot of disruption from an employment perspective, what's the role TCS is playing?
Thank you, Nihil, and thank you, Minister. First of all, I'd like to echo what just Rajan said, you know, and the Minister mentioned. You know, TCS brought the distribution of work to the world, how the work could be distributed across various parts of the world, depending on where you found the best talent and where the it made from the, you know, sense from the perspective of the price point. Now, in the wake of COVID-19, we were able to pivot very quickly with the help of what Minister spoke to a model which we call a secure borderless workspaces model, where we brought the customer's business to a business as usual model in no time. And I think that speaks of India's resilience, India's way of how India performs. So that's one part. And that has really worked, sir. And I would compliment your ministry and how you know, you liberalized the regime, as you mentioned. So thank you very much for that. On a job creation, as you know, TCS is a global company, 450,000 people operating 46 countries. Let me just talk about the US. In the US, since 2014, we've been one of the largest two job creators in the country. And that has worked because we find that as you globalize, as you work in various parts of the world, it's very important that you make the communities flourish. If the communities flourish, then you will flourish. This is the basic mantra of the Tata Group. Wherever Tata's group has been operating, the communities there have flourished. And it's in our DNA. As you know, 50% of the Tata Group is, or Tata Sons Limited, is owned by two charitable trusts. So every dollar or dividend that we declare at the Tata Group level, 50 cents go back to public. And this is what we are seeing. The other aspect that you're seeing is the whole upskilling and reskilling of communities, of companies, people. So as the newer technologies have come in, and we just talked about that, you know, the areas of agile, the areas of cloud, the areas of artificial intelligence and automation, and the whole data insights, the business analytics, that requires that people are trained in those new technologies. And we have taken it in two parts. First, skilling and making sure that our people are up to date. They go to our customers with the latest digital technologies. So we trained out of 450,000 people, or 400,000 people are already trained in Agile and the new digital technologies. When it comes to the communities, we have two programs, the two flagship programs going on, which one is the Ignite My Future in School, which speaks of computational thinking. And we approached a number of school administrations in the US to have this incorporated into the curriculum. And Nikhil, as you know, it is not that easy to change, but when they saw the value of this program, which has been developed along with Discovery Education, we now have trained over 700,000 students across the country in the computational thinking technologies. The other program, which I just wanted to take 15 seconds for that, is the GoIT program, which is more of, as Minister said, you know, how do you not only consume apps, but create apps? So in the schools in the US, we've been talking to them as to what is the way in which you come and not just consume, but you become creator of those apps. And that has created a movement, a momentum, which basically is working to get more and more kids into the STEM careers in the US. So working out of India, where we are doing secure borderless workspaces, but at the same time, making sure that the corporations across the world are supported well, and at the same time, the communities get the advantage of what we have to offer, is really the basis of what we are doing here.
Thank you, Surya. Minister Prashad, if you could just comment on that, but also talk a little bit about, we talked a lot about India's competitive advantages in this moment. I think this is going to be a signature time for India. Tell us a little bit about some of the challenges and what companies such as TCS and Qualcomm can do more to accelerate India's growth at this time.
Nikhil, just to tell you what Rajan talked about, Arogya Setu. It is a fine symbol of India's technological prowess. Challenging time, nearly 120 million Indians have downloaded this app. How it works, very simply, very simple principle. If you have come in contact with a person who has a secondary contact of COVID, it will be yellow. If you have come in contact with a person who is going to be infected, it will be orange. And in the event you have come in contact with a person who is confirmed, it will become red. Therefore, it is warning you. It is cautioning you. Please take care. It has inbuilt testing facility by use of Bluetooth technology. You know, by this, we have been able to identify 4,000 hotspots, which you have told. And what the authorities do, in the event a person A is likely to become, say, red, then the system tells all his relations and friends, you be aware, be distant from him to save yourself, because the disease is contagious. You know that. It is fully compliant with privacy. Non-positive data automatically starts get deleted after 30 days, and any positive data after 60 days. This is how it works. And most important, you cannot upload this app. That is your right. We can't force you.
Right.
This is how it works. So that is a classic case. Now, companies like TCS or Qualcomm, there are so many other companies, and many of them are Indian companies. They have done so well. After all, don't forget companies like Infosys, companies like Wipro, companies like TCS. They all began from India.
Yeah.
And please don't forget, Indian IT systems are serving nearly 500 Fortune companies of the world, paying taxes, creating jobs globally. And a larger Indian IT system job, I must tell you very briefly, nearly 4 million work in Indian IT system directly, out of which one third are women. Don't forget it. And nearly 10.25 million, 1 crore 25 lakh, work indirectly. And this whole intake keeps on going. Even the COVID is not going to stop. Maybe they're working from home. Maybe the nature of work may change, but the nature of recruitment will continue. In electronic manufacturing, as I told you, we have done so well. Only in mobile manufacturing in the last 5.5 years, we have given employment to nearly 700,000 people directly and indirectly. And overall, 2 million have been recruited in electronic manufacturing. Therefore, all this, automatic FDI, ease of doing business, all the rules, regulations being liberalized. This is all creating an enough ecosystem. And most important, India's human resource. I think two shining example of India's human resource are sitting in the panel, for the TCS and Qualcomm. They're Indians after all. Therefore, this great legacy of India's technological human resource, globally recognized as a strong benchmark. And by the way, Nikhil, today Google is being headed by an Indian.
Yes.
Microsoft is being headed by an Indian. So many global technological giant companies, even your IBM being headed by an Indian. All this is a very vibrant symbolism of the technological capability of Indians.
I believe there are, I think, 43 of the Fortune 500 companies are now headed by Indians, and so
yes,
So it's a remarkable, and as an Indian myself, it's a moment of great pride.
Itself is a very, very robust indication that the moment of India has arrived. It's a democracy led by a leader, Narendra Modi, who is globally popular, pro investment. You must have heard his speech today. He has appealed to the globe to invest in India. But this is how it works. And I think India's moment has arrived.
Thank you, Minister. I think, Priyanka, I think we're out of time. But I think I just want to thank the panel. Thank you, Surya. Thank you, Raja. Mr. Minister, your comments about lychees have made me hungry. If there's one thing I miss about growing up in India, it's the lychees. So if you send some to Surya and me, who are stuck in New Jersey, we'll appreciate it. Thank you very much. And Priyanka, I think I'm turning it over to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.